Thank you for coming. Last talk of the conference. I hope you're still able to listen and to learn and not all tired and ready to go home. Today I want to talk a bit about static analysis of PHP code. First about me, my name is Ruven. I'm a software developer for roughly 10 years now, mostly working on the web. I work for a company called Contentful. We produce a content management developer platform with an API as its core, and my job is that of an ecosystem developer. That means I'm responsible for maintaining the PHP SDK and all the framework integrations. That means I work with many different code bases, many different code styles, Laravel, Symfony, Zend, and I have to be able to quickly switch context between different frameworks. Before I get into the talk itself, maybe let's meet my audience a little bit. Who actually uses static analysis in their day-to-day development? All right, few. Who does it on their own machine? Nobody? Ah, okay, couple. And who does it on their CI server? Well, a few hands. All right. So what is static analysis? Static analysis is analyzing software without actually executing it, so just by looking at the code. The opposite of that would be dynamic analysis. So in PHP, there are a couple of tools. The most famous ones are probably Xdebug and XHProf, which are able to profile the code while it's running on the server in production. Unit testing is also a form of dynamic analysis, depending on what you do, if you collect stats about the code in the process of testing. But today, I really want to use static analysis. So I want to not execute the code. I just want to look at the files. So why would I do that? Well, first of all, it saves me time on unit tests. Because who here is excited about writing unit tests? Who loves writing them? Nobody. Oh, wait, OK, one. OK. I'm sorry, but it's OK. Also, code reviews. Who has ever done a code review and the most comments you got were about the code style, how things were formatted, variables that were poorly named, maybe wrong indentation? That's annoying and a waste of time. I don't need somebody to tell me, well, I don't need to tell somebody, oh, your indentation is off, go back and fix that. Computer can do that far easily and far cheaper than I could ever do it. And also, some people write unit tests that are very boring, but get your test coverage up. So they're not really about trying to figure out, how can I break this, or does this actually work? Just want to get the high coverage number, which doesn't really help us that much. So this is actually an example of our PHP SDK. The most boring unit test ever, it just checks, is this actually an instance of the class I expected it is? That doesn't tell me much, because that it's very unlikely to ever break this unit test. But it gets my coverage up. And any random PHP project is probably full of these tests. And they're not really helpful. And most of these tests, they only cover what the developer who wrote them actually thought about. Any error you didn't think about, you will never discover with unit tests. And that's where static analysis can help you. It's also super easy to integrate in your continuous integration suite. And it also avoids all of these things where you mock the world and don't really test anything else anymore. So you can actually find issues you would never have found in unit tests. And PHP 7 actually made static analysis a whole lot more exciting because it's more to reason about. The abstract syntax tree makes it easier to pass PHP code into a form that can actually be analyzed. Scalar types give me not just more type safety on the runtime, also give me more information to work with when analyzing the code. And strict types give me assurance that the scalar types actually match what I'm getting into, also, again, making it easier to analyze code. Unfortunately, PHP is very dynamic, and dynamic languages are the worst enemy of any static analysis. So PHP has reflection, variable variables, don't use those. You can reference various objects and classes by strings, or with strings. All of these things make it very hard to reason about the code. So you get more out of static analysis the more you avoid using these constructs in your code. If you have a very dynamic code base, the prime example would be WordPress, which is full of variable variables and functions referenced by strings. Static analysis is not going to find many bugs in your code. If you have a very modern code base that avoids these constructs, for example, Symfony or Laravel-based applications, you're probably going to get much more out of it. So what would be some tools you could use for state analysis? Well, there are dozens of them. They're just some popular open source tools. There are also commercial offerings, like Scrutinizer CI or SensuLabs Insights. But today I want to focus on open source tools. So you can broadly categorize them in a couple of categories. First of all, you have those more concerned about how the code looks, so checking the style of the code. Then you have some that are focused on collecting statistics about your code, being able to reason about long-term trends or what actually the state of the code is in a global fashion. Then you have things that are more focused about automatically fixing things or helping you with migrations. So they're a weird mix between actually style and bugs, because they're not bugs per se, but they might turn into bugs when you move to a new PHP version. Then you have tools focused on security issues. These are very mixed bags. Many of them find certain bugs, but they also give a very false sense of security. So don't trust these tools blindly and think just because they pass, you don't have any security issues. And then you have things work focused on good architecture in your code. And you have things working on type safety. And today I want to talk about these four tools. Farn, phplog, phplint, and Dagtrap, and tell you a little bit more about what they can do for your code base. Let's start with phplint. Who's using it? A couple of people. Everybody who said they're using state analysis. So phplint is finding syntax errors in your code. Who here has ever shipped a syntax error on their production server? A couple of people are brave enough to admit it. I've done it. I've done it more than once. It sucks. Yeah, there's nothing worse than not even being able to run your application because you overlooked a silly missing semicolon. phplint running as your CI will 100% prevent that from ever happening again. So what it does is actually compiles the PHP source code, your PHP code, with the same compiler that's running in production. So there's 100% no difference between these compilers as long as you use the same version on your CI system and in production. It's already installed on your computer because it's just a PHP binary. And it can be used to test compatibility with multiple PHP versions to an extent. You won't find all errors, but if you're switching to a new PHP version, running phplint as the first thing is going to get you pretty far. So let's take this example code, again, actually from our SDK. Can anybody spot the syntax error? Yeah, speak up. Yeah, the namespace line is missing the semicolon. And if I run the phplint, it actually tells me syntax error found in one file, unexpected use, to use expecting a curly brace, and that's because the semicolon is missing. If you use this on your CI system, do yourself a favor, make your life a little bit easier. Use parallelint. If you have a large code base, it's going to check multiple files at the same time, reducing your CI time. It usually sucks very badly. I've seen many CI systems where, after every commit, they're running for 60 minutes. The feedback cycle is also way too long. Try to get quick results in your CI system. Use parallelint. phplog. Who's using phplog? A couple people over there. phplog is giving you statistics about your project. They help you get an idea of the complexity of the project you're looking at right now. One of the first things I do whenever I touch a new code base is actually run phplog just to get an idea of how it's structured, like how many classes are there, are they using a lot of global variables, all these things I can get from phplog. I was also able to generate a CSV report of these data, and you can graph long-term trends and see if your code base is actually evolving in a good direction or if it's just getting more and more messy. So the output is probably a little bit hard to read from the back. Looks like this. This is the basic size overview, how many classes are there, how many lines per class, all of these things. More interesting, you can actually see the cyclomatic complexity as a statistic of a global view. Who knows what cyclomatic complexity is? Okay, for those who don't know, cyclomatic complexity is the measure how many distinct paths are there through a given method or class. The more paths there are, the harder it is to test it, because I'm always going to need at least as many tests as the number of paths there are in your method to actually get full coverage of the method. So allow complexity of the methods is going to make it much easier to write actual unit tests and not integration tests. If you're getting serious about measuring the complexity, Do yourself a favor, use PHPMD, which is actually going to give you reports on the individual function level or method level. Looking at these numbers, I'm actually doing pretty good here. The maximum method complexity is 11. I usually aim for at most 10, like absolute worst case. So 11 is acceptable. That's not great if you have 10s, but it's doing pretty OK. Minimum complexity is 1, so your complexity is never going to get lower than 1, because a method without any code is worthless. You can also see the dependency, how interconnected is your code. You can see roughly the structure, how many classes are there traits being used, are there actually interfaces in the code base. It's just giving you a very good idea of how the code is looking in a global perspective. One of my favorite tools is DepTrack. DepTrack was released like half a year ago, written by Tim Glabisch at Sensio Labs in Germany. DepTrack is analyzing the architecture of your code. So every software has layers. Everybody here is probably familiar with model view controller patterns. Well, there should be rules about these layers and how they interact with each other. So, and these rules, even if you tell them to people and yourself, if you have ingrained them, you're probably going to violate them at some point of time because, oh yeah, just lost this one shortcut where I called the service from the entity, won't hurt anybody. It will hurt you. And DepTrack comes in and helps you avoid these. So what you do is you define the layers of your architecture. Then you define what layers are allowed to access any other layer. And that's it. Then you just run it, and you get nice detailed reports what the violations are. Let's look at an example. So you configure it with a YAML file. So here I have two layers in my application. I have controllers and I have entities. There are a couple more I just left out, but I basically define it by using the namespace. This is again from a real project, so it's actually a bug I've built because I was doing the project in a hurry for a friend, and so I needed to get quick results, and the result was, oh, sorry, I forgot something, the rule set. I actually have to define which layers are allowed to access which other layers. So my controller is allowed to access service, entities, and forms. Services can access repositories, commands can access entities, entities can access validators. But it's not possible that an entity accesses a controller. That's just bad design. So what it does, it parses all the files in your code. It stores the relationship between which class accesses which other class. It's using PHP RST from Nikita Popov for the parsing, so it's all running in PHP actually. And then it's graphs. It has a graph constructed in memory and checks it for rule violations. The report looks a little bit like this. So in this case, I have, I don't know if you can read this, a service PDF order that depends on an entity. That's a violation, and also gives me a nice graph about it, and I can tell if my code base is actually following these rules I've defined. This is especially useful if you have large applications. This one's a fairly small one with like 20, maybe 25 classes. If you have a very large application with many developers working on it, you're going to have a ton of these violations most likely in them, unless you're doing very, very good code reviews. But again, you can save time on these code reviews by just having automatic checks for these very common errors and avoid even to bring them up in your code reviews. So that's DepTrack. Another one, very new, very famous, is Fun. Anybody actually using Fun yet? One? Just one? All right. Anybody heard of it before? Also just one. OK. So Fun has one mission, really, and that is make PHP great again. So Fun is actually written by Rasmus Lerdorf, and it's trying to bring type safety to PHP. So it checks the doc blocks for the types. It also checks for signature mismatches. So it's using both the doc blocks and the type hints you add. And then it's checking every single function call, every single method call after the signature, and checks if the types actually match. It also checks for unused code. There are easier ways to check for that than using Fun. But if you're going to want these type safety checks anyway, you might as well get that too. So how it works is it makes two passes over your code base. First, it builds a list of all classes, functions, methods, and the signature. Then it goes to each function again and collects the type of every variable. The type might be very easy if you just assign it a value and then keep using that variable. It might actually be a mixed type, so if you assign an int and then an if condition, assign a string. Then it can either be an int or a string. It might actually be impossible to determine because the type actually comes from an input outside of your library, maybe through a controller argument from a web service, or maybe from a command line input. And what it looks like is like this. So this is, again, example code from our own project. Can anybody see the error? Sorry? No, OK. So the error it says is, plan type mismatch return, returning type null, but that description is declared to return string. So here we say, this function always returns a string. But in this case, if the description is null, I'm actually returning null. And boom, I don't have type safety anymore. Apparently, you all wouldn't have found it in a code review. So Farn actually saves you from this error. Another one. Anybody seen the error? This one is easier. You should be able to see it. Yeah. So I say it's an object, but I assign it an array. Makes no sense whatsoever. I'm dumb. And it's finding just that error. All right, one more. Anybody find the error in this one? I'm sorry? No, there's a result. There's just a lot of code here. I just left out some parts. Also, result is defined. Yeah, but the return type is not defined. That's OK. Yeah. So he said there's a mixed return type. But that's actually OK, because I didn't define a return type. So Farn by default always assumes it's mixed. So let's open this up. What it says is argument 2, input 1, is contentful delivery link, but array map takes array. So what it says is this value always needs to be an array. But it might be a link. Can that be? No, it can't. So Farn is confused. Farn sees this instance off here and determines, oh yeah, at some point of time, $result might be a link, but doesn't realize that whenever it is actually a link, we're leaving the function right here. It isn't smart enough to recognize that. And then next step it says, oh yeah, this might be a link, and you're passing it to array map. Don't do that. So don't trust blindly. Always try to understand what the tool is telling you. If you don't do that, you're going to make fixes to your code that don't make any sense. You're probably going to make it worse in your code. Use them as tools to assist your mind. Don't replace thinking about anything in your application by just letting tools dictate what you do. All right, what's the bad news about using Farn? Well, first of all, it requires PHP AST, which is a compiled extension that's, depending on how you work, very trivial or very hard to install. If you're compiling your own PHP binary, you have to compile the library into it. If you're getting it from a distribution, you have to hope they package it for you. Might be difficult to actually use PHP AST. It's not very easy to deal with library code. That's mostly what I'm struggling with. It's very easy to have it analyze a whole application holistically. If I say, OK, this is my library, and here are like 20 functions as entry points, that doesn't really work that well. It's really designed to cover a whole application, not just a library. It's also very, very noisy. The output is hundreds and hundreds of lines for everything it checks. And it's not very good with the error codes about, hey, this was OK or this wasn't OK. So I actually haven't had any luck yet integrating it into my CI system. I'm just running it locally every couple of hours to see is there anything obviously wrong. So what actually might be coming to the future? We talked earlier about that it's PHP has learned more about typing and making it easier to find bugs in your code with that. Well, right now, Farn is using brute force type checking. At just hammering at looking at every statement, figuring out what types could it be, and storing that information. That's how you get bugs like the one we've seen earlier where it's recommending, oh yeah, this doesn't work, while it actually is working. This is roughly as good as it would be using a statically compiled language. Statically compiled, strongly typed languages have the distinct advantage that variables are typed strongly, as in you declare the type of the variable. If you take that away from them, they would probably have around the same quality as fun does right now. Which is to say, it works, it gives you valuable information, but it doesn't cover every corner case. What could really help is a control flow graph. People are playing around with this with PHP right now. There's a library from Anthony Ferrer implementing a very basic control flow graph. Also, we've seen DepTrack is building some graphs about the code, not control flow though. So people are trying to figure out how this fits into the PHP ecosystem and how you can actually construct these graphs from the code. I also know Nikita is working on it for the PHP internals because he actually wants to make optimizations based on these graphs. So I think in the next 12 to 18 months, we're going to see a lot of cool things here. But what could we actually get from a control flow graph? Well, let's take C-Lang, the C compiler sponsored by Apple and Google as part of the LLVM project. Anybody here ever programmed in C? Ah, actually quite a few people. Okay, this is very easy C code, so you should be able to tell what's the error in this code. X is incremented twice, not just once. But X can be zero, who said that? Okay, what's the problem with that? I'm sorry. Yeah, there's a division by zero. So if the input length is zero, actually, that's what I explained by Clang because I don't need to explain it. So Clang actually tells us step by step what conditions have to be assumed for the error to be triggered. So in this case, is variable X is always zero. If the loop condition is false, execution continues on line 25. So the loop condition is false when length is zero, because zero smaller than zero is always false. And then I have a division by zero. It's a C-Lang static analyzer. But it's for C code, C++, and Objective-C. Doesn't work with PHP at all. People have been using it for the PHP internals code, actually writing custom plugins for it to check some of the very special things we have in PHP internals, because PHP internals is not really considered normal C code by some people anymore. It's using a lot of defines and a lot of fancy things for argument parsing. So people actually have been writing custom plugins for C-Lang to find more bugs in PHP internals. So this is really an eye to the future. It's not something you can use right now. So bottom line, there are dozens of tools. Don't use all of them. Try to pick those that actually give you value for your project, that actually help you achieve results. We had the talk on Friday about what's business value, what are the objectives. Don't just blindly try the new tool, put it in your CI, and force everybody to adhere to its rule. Think about what value do you get from it. If it saves time and it code reviews, that's awesome, use it. If it's just more noise, don't use it. Do make them part of your continuous integration setup, whenever possible. It's the only way to actually enforce that your code at all times adheres to the rules. If you have to go back and find the bug you introduced 1 week ago, you probably have a problem. Just make them run on every commit. Never trust. These tools are super advanced compared to what we had just 2 years ago, but they do make a tremendous amount of mistakes. Don't trust them blindly. Always think, what does this tool want from me? Is this actually an error? And how can I prevent it? Don't just follow, oh yeah, this must be wrong, I'm going to refactor this right now. Don't do that. All right, that's it. Thank you very much for listening, and please do run static analysis on your code and force your coworkers to do it too, so you don't spend time debugging issues in production and don't spend time on code reviews telling people the annotation is wrong. That helps nobody. Thank you very much. Questions? Okay, question was, are there any tools which detect classes that are used but not existing? Fun is actually one of them. If Fun can't collect the information it needs to check every single method signature, it's going to complain very loudly about it. I think there's also a PHP CS plugin, so the code style checker, that allows for the same thing. It's actually a pretty easy test to write yourself. So with these underlying libraries that many people have now written, mostly Nikita Popov, Anthony Ferrer, it's actually fairly easy to build your own state analysis tool, like DepTrack was built in just a couple of weeks by one guy. So if you have custom needs like these, look at PHPCS, the plugin infrastructure is very good. If it's not covering that easily, build your own. It's really not that hard for simple cases like this one. Anything else?
Is there anything you could use to detect dynamic method invocations? Like if you have a variable of type object and somebody is calling methods on it? For instance, I would like to analyze this and prevent it in my code because it's unsafe and not vectoring aware.
What do you mean by dynamic method, but like strings as method names?
Like or you have a variable of type object and only at runtime you know what it's really inside and you're calling methods on it.
Okay, so basically if you have methods X going beyond your interface and people just call stuff on it. I don't think any tool does it out of the box.
Like PHPStorm is not doing this. It's ignoring that completely.
Fun is currently, I think, Fun is giving you a warning about it. It doesn't error out. So Fun tells you why it's not safe necessarily. JetBrains actually does it with the IDE, which you can't run on CI.
Well, actually, PHPStorm is not doing this, unfortunately. Like you can get an object out of your dependency injection container and call methods on it, and you actually don't know what kind of object it is.
Okay, if you don't define anything, then it doesn't warn you. If you define an interface and you have more methods in it than what the interface covers and you try to call them, then it's going to warn you about them. Since PHP is weakly typed, all tools default to the case, if you don't specify any times, I'm going to make a best guess, and if I can't guess, I'm just going to silently ignore it. That would be, again, something you could probably cover with a custom plugin. But I don't know any tool who has a strict mode for something like this. Would be a good idea, though. Any other question? Yeah, somebody up there?
Is there some data format, XML, JSON, or something like that? Are there some standards for reporting the found issues? And does Fun have some kind of reporter of this style?
So there are some standards. The most popular is probably JUnit, coming out of the Java world. They're all mostly designed for unit testing, not for standard analysis. So I've set up very weird Jenkins configurations trying to pass all of these JUnit files generated by various tools into usable graphs. The fun stops right there. Today, I'm mostly just looking at pass or fail. So does it error out or not? Because usually it's not a big deal to just dive into the logs and figure out the error, especially if you use something like Travis CI or Circle CI, which don't do easy reporting based on the results. So that would be my recommendation. If you really want the automation and the graphing, JUnit is probably your best bet. Many tools cover it. If Fun in particular does it, I'm not sure, to be honest. Other questions? All right, thank you very much. I think there's closing in half an hour, and then there's lunch.